Let's get started today. We're going to talk about linear models. Just to recap very briefly what we talked about last time, we discussed basically the framework of machine learning, and we described it as a collection of tasks that you can do to help you solve various real-world problems. And two of those most important tasks were classification, which is learning to apply classes to unseen data from labeled examples, and regression, which is learning to assign or to predict a numeric value for unseen data based on labeled examples. So we're going to stick with those two today. And we are going to go a little deeper into these linear models, these very simple models where we decide to either classify something or to do regression by drawing a line. This is the plan for today. Let me write it down again. So we'll start with a little notation. I mean, you've all had linear algebra, but just to help you get used to the way we write things down and help you refresh some of these things, we'll just briefly discuss the notation and how exactly you define a line in a high-dimensional space. And then most of the lecture is going to be about how we search for a good model. We always have called the lecture linear models, but it's really mostly about model search in general. So I'm using these linear models because they're very simple as a good way to explain how we search for models. So we'll talk about search, and we'll look at a few algorithms. First up, random search. It says evolutionary search because the slide is wrong. We're going to talk about simulated annealing. Then this break. And after the break, we're going to talk about the most important search algorithm of all, not just today, but I think in general in machine learning, which is called gradient descent. All of this will be in the context of regression, because classification is a little bit more tricky in this context. So that's what we're going to finish up with, how to apply this to classification. So I'll start with the notation. Like I said, the first half, most of the lecture is going to be about regression. So this will be an example problem, a little bit of example data that we will use as a running example to illustrate these things. So it's a very simple one-dimensional regression problem. We have one feature, x, and we want to predict y based on these five examples. So the task is basically, and it's a linear model, so the task is to fit a line through these points here. You can see they're quite linear, but not exactly linear. So there's a little bit of noise. So how do we define a linear function in a way that works in any number of dimensions? That's always the trick, right? We can define a line in two dimensions. We need to define a linear function in any number of dimensions. So in more than one dimension, it becomes a plane or a hyperplane. Basically, the mathematics is always the same. If we have one model
If you have a model with one feature X, like we saw here, then it's just like your high school linear function. You have two parameters, W and B, and you pass it a feature X. X multiplies by W, then you add B. And this gives you a linear function. That shouldn't be new to you. And if you go to more features, then all you do is you just add one coefficient per feature, one W. And the argument here, this is wrong, this should say x1 and x2, the argument of this function. So two features would just have three parameters, W1, W2, and B. We multiply W1 with the first feature, we multiply W2 with the second feature, and we add B, our bias or our intercept, that's called, which is not multiplied by any of the features. Which, if you've had a look at the homework exercise, you will know to be the in product of the red parameters and the input. So if we represent our input as a feature vector, so a vector containing all of the features, and we represent all our W weights also as a parameter vector, also a vector, and we multiply the two, we take the transpose of W and multiply it by X. That basically works out this way. So if the weight W1 is multiplied by X1, W2 is multiplied by X2, and so on and so on, and they're all summed. And then on the end we add B. And this, of course, this works in any number of dimensions, so this gives us a way to describe a linear function in general. If you want to get rid of B, make it even more simple. Oh, sorry, I'm getting ahead of myself. So for any number of features, it looks like this. X is a vector of n features. W is a vector of n coefficients. We take their inch product and we add a scalar B to scale the whole going up and down. If you want to make it even more simple, you want to make it look like this. You can actually add V to the weight vector and add a 1 at the bottom of every feature vector. So it's like adding one feature to our data set that we force to always be 1. And as you see, if you take the dot product of this, if you multiply this by this, then the B gets multiplied by 1, so it works out to this kind of stuff. The general principle here at work here is quite interesting. We'll come back to this a couple of times. Is that we've made our model simpler. So we've removed this B, made our model simpler. But we've augmented our data set with an extra feature. We've added one feature to our data set. And that means that the simple model is as powerful as the slightly more complicated model. So often when you have a simple model that you want to make more powerful, you can switch to a more powerful model. But you can also add features, even very arbitrary or very artificial features like this, to make your model powerful, more powerful. That's something we'll come back to later. For now, we'll stick with this notation for a linear function. So we'll make the bias, the intercept, as we saw last time, we now need to define a loss function. So we have, for every vector like this, every vector W, every choice of vector W, and every choice of B, we have a linear function. And some of them will be very good for our data, and most of them will be very bad for our data. We need a way to distinguish that. We need a way to assign to each model a value that says, you're very good, you're very bad. What we call a loss. We saw this last time already. This is one of the most commonly used loss functions in regression, not the only one, but a very common one. And essentially what we're doing here, we have this different data set here, and we plot the line to it. We're going to look at the loss for this, compute the loss for this line. What we do is we compute all the residuals, which is a fancy name for the
these little bars here, the difference between what the model predicts, which is the value on the line, and what the data says actually is, which is the dot. So the little bar is how long here. We square all of those. So this part here is what the model predicts, and this part here is what the data tells us it should be. So this is the difference. We square those. We sum all of them, so we sum the squares of all of these little bars, and we take the average of the basis. And that's how good the model does, which is a reasonable way to do it. And the squares, as we mentioned last time, is to make sure that they're all positive. Because if we sum a big error, big positive error, and add it to a big negative error, they will cancel out, even though we have very big errors. So we want them to be positive. So this is our loss. What we can now do in two dimensions for our example data set, we do it in we have a one-dimensional feature space, so our line is just a line. Our linear function is just a line, so it has two parameters, which means that we can plot the model space using those two parameters. So we plot a space with the parameter W here and the parameter B here. And for every point in this space, we can compute the loss function for our specific data set. Right? Every point in this space is possible, is a model. It's one choice of W, one choice of B. And we can color it by how well it does. And because of the way our eyes work, we have to color the logarithm of the power of the logarithm of the loss. You can forget about that, you can just think of this as the coloring of the loss. And the brighter it is, the better the model. So our job, when we search, is to find this point. The mark where we are. And you may say, well, that's very easy, it's there. But it's not so easy when you have lots and lots more parameters. Usually your model space can have hundreds, it can have millions of parameters. This can be millions and millions of dimensions. So then you can plot it. And the only thing you can do usually, but the very least you can do usually, is pick a random model, compute the loss for that random model, and then work your way from there. Just to write it down, mathematically, get used to it, this is our problem. So we have some parameters which determine our model, which can be a huge vector of weights or single number or something else, some parameter that determines our model, and they come from a big set, big space of parameters. And we have a loss function with some which is based on some data and some labels. And it's a function of the model. It's always important to remember loss function is a function of the model and the data is a constant in the loss function. And we're just trying to find the parameters such that this loss function is minimized. We'll call them p hat. So trying to find the optimal parameters. Or saying this as good as we can do. So let's look at the first first example. Very simple way of searching, which is called random search. Here's the algorithm. I'll show you a picture in a second. But it basically, you pick a random point in this, this space that we saw, and then you pick another point quite close to it. You see which one of them is better. And if the new point is better, you move to the new point and go again. If the new point isn't better, then you discard it. Which, yeah, seems reasonable, I suppose. That looks like this. Oh, sorry. That's a bit more explanation. So we're in the model space, we pick a random point W. Because we have to define what we mean by close to. And in the simplest version of random search, close to means a fixed distance away in a random direction. So you pick a random direction and you move a fixed distance, fixed small distance in that direction. So you pick randomly between any new model, any W prime on this circle. You pick here. So we end up in, well,
let's say it's better because we're closer to the bright area. So we switch to this point. Now we pick another random point. Let's say we randomly pick this point from any point on the circle. And again, it's better. So we switch to that point. And you keep going and going and going. Until hopefully the model reaches the point that you're happy with. Here's what that actually looks like. So we start here, and all these transparent red bars are failed attempts to find a successor. So here you can see it randomly sampled a couple of successors in this direction, but they were all worse because this is all worse than this. This is all a region of higher loss than this. Until it sampled this successor, and then that one has a lower loss, so then it switched to this point, and then it, I think, immediately switched to this point, and so on. And you can see it goes sort of in a slightly roundabout way, it gets there eventually, and it sort of reaches the region of lower loss. And just to remind you, every point in this space corresponds to a line that we're fitting to our data. So this is, as we're iterating, this is what's happening in feature space. We start with a very random, very poor line, and it slowly sort of gravitates to better and better lines, closer and closer to the kind of fit we'd like to see. So for such a simple model, I'd say this already works very well. And this is actually, well, it's a very simple version of the algorithm, but this algorithm, this type of algorithm, random search, is actually being used at the moment in state-of-the-art machine learning research. There was a paper recently where they used random search on reinforcement learning, and they actually managed to get results that were competitive with the state of the art with such a simple algorithm. Now the nice thing about this data set is that it's convex. The nice thing about this problem is that it's convex. Which is a fancy word, so let me explain it. If we look at it from the side, let's say this is our loss surface, this is our model space. We're trying to find the minimum of our loss surface. A convex loss surface is one with the following property. If you pick any two random points on the loss surface and draw a line between them, then everything in between those points needs to be below the line. That's how convexity is defined. Practically, what it means is that we have one global minimum, and if we follow the loss surface, then we can be sure that we are moving in the right direction. That's not always true, so there are also, so that's a global minimum, by which we mean if we found a minimum, then we know it's the only one. So we found the optimal one. That's not always true. In fact, in the most interesting models, the loss surface is far from convex. Here's a little example. This there's no data set corresponding to this. I just googled a random function with a bunch of peaks and a bunch of troughs. So 2D looks like this. This is our the z-axis is our loss value of these. Are our parameters W and V. And as you can see, it has a couple of areas where the loss drops and where the loss is locally at its lowest point, but only one area where the loss is globally the minimum. So these we call, this what we call global minimum, and the other ones we call local minimum. And if we look at what random search does when we let it run on this data set. We started at the top right, at the top left corner. As you can see, it beelines straight for one of these local minima. And no matter how long we let it run, you can see I let it run for quite some time. These are all failed attempts to find a successor that has lower loss, but it's just stuck there. Once it's stuck here, nothing in the neighborhood will help it climb out of this local minima to get to the global minimum. Local minimum,
to get to the global minimum.
So in a word, random search like this, if you do it like this, is very sensitive to local minima. And one way to avoid that is by using simulated annealing.
And I feel I need to apologize here for the way we name things in machine learning.
Basically, simulated annealing is a very tiny variation on random search with a very tiny change, and suddenly the name changes from random search to something like simulated annealing.
I won't try and explain to you where that name comes from.
It's a long story, but this is just
what it's called.
So the algorithm is exactly the same. We start with a random point, we have this loop, we pick another random point close to it, and we check if the loss of our new point is better than the loss of the old point. If so, we switch to the new point.
If it's worse, however, this is where the things change.
If it's worse, then we still switch, but with a probability, with a fixed probability. So if we find a better point, we just switch to a better point.
If we find a worse point, we flip a coin, say.
And if the point comes up heads, we still switch to the new point, even though it's worse.
Which gives us some probability that if we're stuck in one of these local minima, we'll start climbing out with some probability.
Here's what that looks like.
So what you can see here is that
we start in the same corner, and on our way down to the first minimum, we get lost a little bit, we start jiggling around, but here it hits the goal of the local minimum, and it wanders around the walls. So it's not like the random search, it doesn't stick to this local minimum and stay there. It sort of wanders around,
trying to climb out and falling back in and falling back in, until finally it gets a long enough run of these successful samples here where it gets where it's allowed to climb up
in succession. And it actually climbs out. It does a little thing here, and then it finds its way to the global minimum.
And of course, if we let this run long enough,
it will also climb out of the global minimum again. And it might go to this area or back here. We don't know. It's all random.
But that's not a big problem, so long
as during our iteration we just remember what the lowest loss is that we've encountered.
If we just keep one model in memory, which is the lowest we've encountered,
then we can let this run for as long as we want to.
And the longer we let it run, the more sure we are that the model that we're remembering is actually the optimal model.
Of course, we've taken a very simple way of choosing a successor, mostly for the sake of making these plots readable. So what we do is we choose any one of the models that are a fixed distance away from our current choice. There are lots of other ways of doing it. One thing you can do is sample from a random uniform distribution on this ball, this hypersphere. So instead of only selecting models on the edge, the models are anywhere. You select any model that is a distance up to R from your current model, which is because then you can make smaller steps as well. It would allow your random search or your simulated annealing to converge to a more precise point. And you could even do a sample from a Gaussian distribution. So in this case, most of the models you sample would be inside the hypersphere for a fixed radius. But basically, the entire model space is theoretically possible, could theoretically be sampled. It's just that the further you get away from the current point, the lower the probability is of those models being sampled. This is just to show you that there are different ways of doing this. And I just picked the simplest one. If your model space is not continuous, so it's not a nice plane or a 3D space or ND space, but it's discrete. For instance, if you have a tree model, like this, then there's not like this smooth transition between models. There's not in between any two models you pick, there isn't always another model. This is what we have in continuous space. We have lines. In this space, between any
two points in the space, there's always another point in between, right?
That's continuous.
With trees, it's not continuous. We have these discrete sets. You can still use random search and you can still use simulated annealing so long as you define for your space what it means to be close to.
So here I've defined a kind of graph that says I can move from this tree to this tree by adding a node here, or I can move from this tree to this tree by removing this node. And between any two trees in my huge space of all possible trees, I draw a line. I say these are close together. If one of these edit operations allows me to move from one tree to the other, and then you can search this. I suppose it's a lattice, but this structure you can search
using random search.
Just pick any random starting point, compute the loss for this model for this tree, then pick a successor, compute the loss for that. If it's better, you move there. If it's not better, you stay here. And pick another random one, and so on.
So for random search and simulated annealing, discrete spaces actually work. You can actually apply these to discrete model spaces as well. These methods are what we call black box optimization,
by which I mean
you don't need to really know anything specific about your model. You don't have any specific insight into your model. All you need to do is to be able to compute the loss function for a given model. If I give you a model and you can compute the loss function, that's enough to run random search, to run simulated annealing, and to run the next type of model that we'll talk about briefly. So that's what we call black box optimization. So it's very nice and very simple to implement, which is always a bonus. And if you really don't know anything about your problem, you can still use these. The drawback is that if you do know something about your model, if you do have some insight into your model, you can usually do a lot better. We'll talk about that in the second half. But this is the benefit. It's very simple. We only need to compute loss function every model. So they can take a long while. They can get stuck in local minima. And another positive, it also works for discrete model spaces. So that's nice.
If we want to avoid, another way to avoid this problem of getting stuck in local minima is to run a parallel search. So you take your random search and you just run it a couple of times, either literally in parallel at the same time or one after the other. So you run this one, it gets stuck, you pick a new starting point, you run, it gets stuck. You pick a new starting point, it gets stuck somewhere else. You pick a new starting point and it gets stuck here.
And then over all of those runs, you pick the minimum best model that you found. For simulated annealing, so this works, I showed this for random search. For simulated annealing, this makes less sense. Any idea why?
The reason is that simulated annealing is already still bouncing around this model space. Simulated annealing doesn't get stuck like random search does. So with random search, we have to artificially put it somewhere else and let it start again. But with simulated annealing, it can do that on its own. If you wait long enough, it will eventually graduate from here to here. So with simulated annealing, there's not really a big difference between doing 10 runs of 100 iterations or doing one run of 1,000 iterations. Sort of the same thing. The only reason you might want to do things in parallel like this is to literally parallelize it. If you have multiple cores available or if you have multiple machines available, then it's very nice to run searches in parallel to just get the minimum of them. But if you really want to get the most out of a parallel search, the best thing to do is to have this population of searches that are running properly in parallel, but have them occasionally communicate with each other.
So basically, they're just searching in parallel. But every now and then, you allow some of them to communicate in some way, to share what they found, and one of them can say, "I found something really good," and then they will move. They will all move towards the best one in some way. There are a couple of ways of doing this. I've called these population methods, just as a general phrase. I think the most popular one is evolutionary algorithms inspired by biological evolution. So you take a population of models, and the way they search is by you first compute the loss function for all of them. You keep the top half, the best half, and you make them produce through biological means, so to speak, a new population of children. So you pick a mother and father, and you make them have a baby, just by, well, usually just picking a random point in between, or picking the point halfway. And that's your new population of candidates, and then you do the same thing. You kill the bottom half, you create a new population, and you do this over and over again. Lots of variations, of course, are possible. Lots of ways of doing this. I won't go into that, it's not that important, but that's what's what we call evolutionary algorithms, also known as genetic algorithms. And you can do this on, again, on discrete spaces, so long as you can figure out a crossover function. So if you do this on a discrete space like the tree space, then one member of your population is one tree, one member of your population is another tree. You need to figure out what it would look like if those two had a baby. Those two trees mixed, what their offspring would look like. It's called crossover operation. And if you have that, then you can apply evolutionary algorithms also to discrete spaces. There's a couple of other ones like particle swarm optimization, where basically you have a population of models and they actually move through this space, and they tend to move in the same direction, but also slightly in opposite direction, the way birds move through the sky. So if they're close to each other, then they align their movement and their direction, and if they're far away, then they don't. So you get a kind of swarm of models moving through the space. And then there's ant colony optimization, which I won't go into, but it's inspired by ant colonies, as you might expect. So, yeah, all these population methods are just basically ways of doing this parallel search, but allowing a little bit of communication between the current candidates. So here's another idea, mostly as a bridge to what we're going to talk about after the break. I've called this a branching search. I don't know if there's a proper name for it. I just came up with this name. I couldn't find what this is called, so I just thought I'll just call it branching search. Basically, the idea is it's a variation on random search. We call it, we start again with a random point in the plane. But instead of picking one successor, we pick a bunch of successors. We pick k random successor points, and they're all close to w. So they're all on this hypersphere, one fixed distance away from W. And then we just, among this population, among this set of successors we've selected, we just look for the best one in there. We check all their loss functions and we find the smallest one. We call that W prime. And then we do the same thing as we did in random search. If it's better than our current, we switch. If it isn't, then we sample a bunch more names. A bunch more successors. So what we're doing is we're having a little bit more of a look in our local neighborhood to see which direction actually gives us the steepest, the fastest way down, as it were. So here it is with K2. It's basically just random search, except we pick two successors and we choose the best one. And as you can see, it does sort of the same thing as random search. It meanders around and eventually gets a little bit closer to the optimum, but not fast enough here. I've cut it off after a couple of iterations. But what we see is that as we increase
the number of statistically sampled, the direction of in which this random search moves, gets much more direct, looks much more directly towards the region of low loss. And if we increase it to 15, then it sort of
drops right into this valley of low loss.
So it's a very useful thing to do. I mean, it's also more expensive. You have to, every iteration, you have to evaluate many more successors, so it's not necessarily faster overall.
But the point is that if you're investigating some point in your model space and you're looking for a place to go,
and you sort of look around in your local neighborhood and you investigate which direction, you look for a direction in which the loss surface drops the quickest, then you can make your search behave much more in a much more directed way. It sort of knows exactly where to go. And here we've done that through sampling a bunch of directions and picking the one that's best. But actually, in most cases, if we know a little bit of linear algebra and if we know a little bit of calculus, we can actually compute the optimal direction directly. We can just compute the direction in which the loss surface drops the quickest. That's called the gradient. You've seen that a little bit already. So that will give us gradient descent. That's what we're going to talk about after the break. For now, just a little summary. Basically, we've talked about two things that we want our search to do. We want it to escape local minima. In that case, it helps to have a little randomness, as we saw in this
simulated annealing. So we don't just go for the best option that we have. We go for the best option, and with some small probability, we go for a different option.
So you add statisticity, you add randomness to sort of slightly push you around this model space, explore a little bit more. That allows you to escape over minima. And if you want to converge faster, you should inspect the local neighborhood and try and map it out, try and see where, which direction gives you the fastest rate of descent. I'm missing a picture here. But basically, gradient descent is a way of doing that directly, and that's what we're going to talk about after the break. We're a little early. Let's take a 15-minute break and come back here at 5 to 10.
Okay, welcome back. Before we come to gradient descent, I had a couple of very good questions during the break, so I thought I'd talk about those publicly to everybody, since some of you might have the same questions. First question is, how do I know my loss function is, whether or not my loss function is convex? So I showed you, if you have this convex property of your loss function, then that's very nice, and then you know that you have global optimum, and things like random search work very well. So how do I know? Can I prove this? You can measure it empirically from your function, but you can't prove it. If you write down your loss function, and you write down this convexity property mathematically, then you can work out whether or not your loss function for a particular model is convex. And usually, that's already been worked out by somebody for every particular model. So you can just basically look it up. So in the case of linear regression, we know that the loss function is convex. In the case of support vector machines, we know that it's convex. And in the case of deep neural networks, we know that they're usually not convex. another question, just to re-emphasize, when we're doing random search in the simplest way, this is the one I've been talking about, just to emphasize that it can pick any of these points as a successor, and it has no preference for anything. So it doesn't, when it's searching, is it here? So when it's searching,
we can see that there's a region of low loss here, but the algorithm doesn't see that. The algorithm can only see 2 points at this stage of the algorithm. It can only know the loss for 2 points in the model space. So W and for the random point is sample. It might as well sample random point here or here or here. That doesn't matter. So all the algorithm has access to are point samples of the loss. And it picks these things completely randomly. final question, somebody who had already studied simulated computing talked about something called a cooling function.
Which basically scales this probability value as you're iterating.
So this is something you can do with simulated computing. You can look at this probability, you can make it very big when you start iterating, and then when you're pretty sure you're pretty sure you've given enough iterations that you're near the minimum, you can lower that probability and turn it slowly into random search, which is called the cooling temperature sometimes. And you can do a similar thing with random search. You can take this radius and slowly decrease it as time goes on. And then as you know you're nearing the minimum, you take smaller and smaller and smaller steps, which helps you fixate on proper minimum instead of what the random search does now, which is once it gets to a good point, it sort of just jumps around. It's actually nice and just converges. The problem with this kind of scaling and with the scaling of the probability in simulated annealing is that you have to choose how to do it. And there's no real optimal given way to do it. It's another thing you have to tune in your algorithm, which we don't like. We don't like extra things that we have to choose, extra arbitrary parameters that we have to set. So what we really like is an algorithm that dynamically decreases its step size without us telling it what the step size should be. It takes smaller and smaller steps as it gets closer to the minimum. Not based on our judgment, but based on its own judgment of where it thinks it is in this model space. And as it happens, that's what gradient descent can do for us. So let's have a look at gradient descent. First, however, this is going to get a little bit more mathematical than the first half. So let's review a couple of key phrases, key terms, key phrases for basic high school calculus. Just let's refresh this, make sure you and make sure we're on the same page. Terminology-wise, so first of all, the word slope is important in calculus. Here we have two lines. One is minus 1x plus some b, and one is 1/2 x plus some b. And this parameter in the linear function is called the slope. And it's the rate of descent. It's how quickly the line climbs. Specifically, it's how much you climb vertically if you take a step of one horizontal. So you move from one to the right horizontally, you climb 1/2 vertically. And here, if you move one to the right horizontally, we climb minus one vertically, or we descend one vertically. That's called the slope of a line. And the derivative, as you all hopefully know, if the slope gives you the slope of a tangent line. So if you pick a point on some function, this is your function, you pick a point there, you compute the derivative of a point, it will give you the slope of this line that just touches the function only on this point. That's tangent line if you move the function up to the, if you move a line up to the function. So that it just touches it, the derivative gives you the slope at that point. Another way of thinking about this is that the derivative, specifically this line, so the line with this slope plus some bias, you have to translate the line up to actually touch this point. But this line is the best linear approximation to your function at this point. Your function is not linear at all. So it's a parabola in this case. But if we just look at this local neighborhood, it's pretty close to a line. And this line is our best approximation locally of our function. Now that's important.
Because
this linear approximation tells us if we want to find the minimum, where we should go. And finding the minimum, I'm guessing you all did this in high school. If you want to find the minimum of this function, you just look for the point where the derivative is zero, so where the derivative is flat, you have the slope of zero. And where the derivative is zero, you have the extremes of the function, the optimum or the maximum or the minimum. Practically, if the model space has more than one dimension, if the model is a little bit complicated, you can't do that anymore. But what you can still do is look at your local neighborhood and say, well, if this is a linear approximation locally for my line, then what it tells me is that what it tells me is that the minimum of this function is in this direction. Because locally it's a perpendicular slope, it's a descending line. So I should move in that direction. And it's a quite rapidly descending line. So I should take quite a big step in that direction. So if this, the bigger the slope is, the bigger the step we take. And the sine of the slope tells us in which direction. So then we move over here, we compute the derivative again. Still negative, but a little bit more gentle, so we take a smaller step, another step, so we move over here. And we see that as we move closer and closer to the minimum, the line gets flatter and flatter and flatter, and the steps that we take get smaller and smaller and smaller. That's the principle of gradient descent, is that we follow this derivative by locally approximating our function as a linear function. So the question is, can we translate this to model spaces of more than one dimension? Because it works in one dimension, but what if we have multiple dimensions? Well, then every line becomes a plane or a hyperplane. So the equivalent is to find a tangent hyperplane. You have a 3D function like this to find a plane that just touches our function, and then to use that plane to find locally the direction in which the function decreases the quickest, and to find how quickly it decreases to determine our step size. So that's what we're going to try to do. And like I said, this involves a little bit of mathematics, so we'll go slow, but that's what we're moving to. So trying to generalize this idea of following the gradient to the minimum, we're going to generalize that to multiple dimensions. A couple of preliminaries, a couple of things we need. First, vectors. You all know about vectors. They're very simple. You have something like this, so just a 2D vector x contains two numbers, and you can use that to refer to a point in the plane. You just follow this three steps and one step up. X refers to this point. But vectors can also refer, or can also be interpreted as directions. Basically, what we do to interpret this as a direction is we draw a big arrow from the origin to the point it points to. And it's not just a direction, it's a direction with a magnitude. So it's an arrow that points in this direction, and it's an arrow of this length. This is just basically Pythagoras. So it has a length, a magnitude, and a direction. This is just a way of talking about directions. So let's extend this idea of a linear function now to two dimensions. Here we have a two-dimensional linear function, inputs x and y, with two coefficients, three coefficients, sorry. So we have a, b, and c. C should be colored purple. So let's see what these coefficients do. Basically, c is the bias. So if we look at the plane, C helps us translate this plane up or down. Then A is the slope along the x-axis. So if we move one step to the right, we will move A down, because A is negative in this case. and B is the slope in the y direction. So if we move one step up in the y direction, we will move B up.
And this translates to any number of dimensions.
So if you have five dimensions, then you get one slope per dimension. And as you can see, I hope you can sort of visualize this, these two orange lines, they
define a plane.
So for any point in between here, we get this
this planar surface.
So the question is, if you have a function like this, or in this case, the if we write it as a vector, we get a vector like this. With A and B, in the vector.
The question is, if we let's assume for a second we can locally approximate our function with one of these planes, with one of these linear functions, which is the direction of sequence descent? If this is our plane, in which direction does this plane of this linear function increase the quickest? Because that's the direction we're interested in, right? In order to work that out, we need a different direction of the dot product.
Sorry, different definition of the dot product. So this is how we define a function. We forget about the b for a while, because as you can see, the b just translates it up or down, but the direction of sequence descent stays the same. So we pretend we don't have a bias this term.
In this case.
So for this function, what is the direction of sequence descent? We just a function just the dot product of the wave vector and the we can see that quite easily by switching to a different definition of the dot product. This is just the same. It's a basic linear algebra result.
I had a look to see if I could make this more intuitive,
why these things are the same. And it's slightly too much work. So I won't go into it, you'll just have to accept, take my word for it, these things are the same. So this is the magnitude of vector W times the magnitude of vector X times the cosine of the angle between the two vectors. So no matter how high-dimensional your space is, any two lines through it will always have one angle between them. Because two lines define one plane together, and in that plane there will be one angle between them. And you can compute the dot product in this way as well. So now we can ask with this definition, in which direction, let's say we start at the origin, so we start with x is 0, and we take a step of length 1 in any direction, for which direction is fx going to be the biggest, which is the direction of greatest descent? So then our argument is some directional vector of length 1. And for which argument is this value the biggest? Well, we can remove this term, because that's always 1. We've defined it that way, so it's magnitude W times cosine of A. And the cosine of A can take a number of values, anything between minus 1 and plus 1, I think. And it's the highest, it's plus 1 when the angle is 0. So this is maximized when the angle between our input and our wave vector is 0. So they're pointing in the same direction. And since this one has magnitude 1, this one falls out. So we know that basically the direction of greatest descent is the direction in which our wave vector points. So vector W points in a certain direction. That's also the direction of greatest descent. If you don't understand that, don't worry. Just remember, if we have a plane defined by one of these wave vectors, W points in a certain direction, that's the direction of steepest descent. So finally, now we come to the gradient. We're putting the gradient in gradient descent. we do this using partial derivatives. So if we have a function like this, or like this, so three variables, this is a function of two variables,
but the idea is the same. If we have a function of some number of variables, we can take a partial derivative with respect to any one of these variables. So if we have a function of multiple variables, two, one output, we can take as many derivatives as the function has inputs. So in this case, there are three derivatives to take. And if we take all of those derivatives and stick them together in a row vector, usually we use column vectors for the gradient, we use the row vector. If we stick them together into a row vector, that's the gradient. That's all it is. And the gradient is the slope, defines the slope, defines the W of the tangent height. And we'll look at a practical example later of how to compute and use this gradient. But for now, let's actually define how this gradient descent works and look at how simple it is. This is the whole algorithm. There's no more checking whether we're going in the right direction, because we know we're going in the right direction because we've computed the gradient. The gradient tells us we're going in the right direction. We'll just start at a random point. And we compute the gradient. We move in the opposite direction, because the gradient is the direction of steepest descent and we want to go downhill. So that's why this is negative. We scale the gradient back a little bit by a uniform distance, because we've approximated our function as a surface, as a flat surface. But that's not usually correct. Usually it's not a linear function. So the further, the more aggressively we follow the gradient, the more wrong we are. So we need to stay in this small neighborhood around our point, where the assumption that our function is locally linear still holds. We need to stay in that neighborhood. So we take small steps, we scale the steps size by something. Eta, something usually between these two values somewhere. And we subtract that from our current point, updates, and then we just loop this over and over and over again. Let's see what that. Oh, yeah. So, practical example. Any questions so far, by the way? Is it all clear or not clear, but you. Oh, yes. Sorry?
Eta.
Yeah? What was the question?
So
how do you choose it?
Yeah.
Yeah, so the question is, how do you choose eta? You just try some stuff, see how it works. This is one of the fundamental things you just have to try in machine learning. So let's go back to our example. This is our model space, our loss surface for our running example. And we have our loss function here. As you remember, these are the residuals, square the residuals, take the average, and that's our loss function for a particular model. So what we're looking for is the gradient of the loss function with respect to our parameters, which is this. We take the gradient, we take the derivative with respect to W, and we take the derivative with respect to V. And that's our gradient. That's our direction that we want to follow. We want to follow the opposite of that direction. So this is probably the most math-heavy slide. We'll go through the derivation step by step, which is just basic taking the derivative. So it's called partial derivative, which may sound fancy, but it's just basically taking the derivative of this function with respect to this parameter, and anything else we treat as constant. So first thing we do, this is a sum. So we can split the derivative of the sum is the derivative of the individual terms. Basically take the sum sign, move it outside. So now we have a sum over all the derivatives of the individual residuals.
Now we have to deal with this square in here, and we deal with that by the chain rule. So we know how to deal with this as it diverges with the argument, it just moves it to the front, we know how to do that. But that's not allowed because we're not taking the derivative with respect to the argument. So we use the chain rule, where first we take the derivative of this with respect to the argument, and then we multiply it by the derivative of this with respect to the actual direct variable. So now here we can just use the exponent rule and move the 2 out in front. So 2 gets moved out in front and falls out of the sum sign, so we move it out of the sum. And here we take the derivative for all of these terms individually, and the last two terms are both constants because W doesn't appear. So these become zero, and only this term remains, and these W's cancel out, and xi remains. So this is the derivative of our loss function with respect to W.
And you can simplify this further to make it look a bit nicer.
Well, you'll do that if you follow the homework next homework exercise. Same thing holds for the loss with respect to B. It's a small mistake here, sorry. So if we do the same thing here, we end up with the same thing except here we take the derivative with respect to B. So this whole thing turns into 1. We get the same thing except this xi disappears.
So it'll all be online, so you'll have time to follow through this at your own speed later if you review the lectures. But this gives us our derivative, so now we can perform the gradient descent algorithm on our loss surface. And it goes like this. So as you can see, it's a lot nicer and a lot less random than the random search. And it just, there's no more failed attempts because it doesn't try anything, it just computes the derivative and falls straight into this hole of low loss. Oh, yes?
Local minima.
Yeah, I'll try to do that. The question is, don't you have a problem with local minima?
And the answer is all the horses.
Because first, let's look at how this looks in the feature space.
Again, very nice sort of mathematical clean look to it. No randomness, no noise. It just graduates into this perfect line. Actually, if you look here, you can see that it overshoots a little bit. So gradient descent can sort of overshoot a little bit. It tends to behave like a kind of marble falling into a bowl. So it goes back and forth a little bit. But you can't really see that here, because it's too the scale is too small.
So now we come to your question.
Don't you have a problem with local minima?
Yes. If we apply this to a non-convex function, well, let's just see what the result is.
As you can see, it goes straight for the local minimum. It does so in a very nice, clean way. But there's absolutely no chance of this ending up in the global minimum.
If we started somewhere else, then it does end up in the global minimum.
So you can do parallel search with gradient descent to help find global minimum.
But basically, the moral of the story is, gradient descent doesn't help you with the problem of local minima. It helps you with the other problem of finding a minimum quickly and accurately. But if you want to escape local minima, you still need to add some kind of stochasticity or
come up with some other trick, do things in parallel.
In a few weeks, I think 2 or 3 weeks, we will talk about an algorithm called stochastic gradient descent, which is far and away the most popular search algorithm used in machine learning today. And that is a sort of a very simple way of dealing with this problem and helping you to some extent escape local minima. But for now, plain old gradient descent, it doesn't solve that problem. That's true. Something I should mention is that the problem the problem I used here as a running example you can actually do the old high school trick of setting the derivative equal to zero. So if we set both of the partial derivatives equal to zero, write this out, and solve for w and solve for b, then actually in this case you can solve that and just get w and b directly. That wouldn't make for a very good example, and it's not how we do things normally, because normally we have more complicated models where this doesn't work. But you should remember, if you have a problem this simple, you can actually just compute the solution directly. You can actually just jump to this point directly without searching in this specific case. So it's just an example, a simple example to understand how these searches work. So last on the program is classification. How do we apply this to classification? Any questions so far before we move on, actually, about the mathematics? All right. So let's look at classification. Here we have 2D input space, 2D feature space, I should say, and a linear model telling us which half of the space is blue and which half of the space is red. So first up, how do we define a linear classifier? How do we use this linear function to define a classifier? Basically, we say we take a linear function. In this case, I've written without bias, usually you add bias. Basically, you say if a linear function is equal to zero, we are exactly on the decision boundary. If it's bigger than zero, we classify it as blue. And if it's smaller than zero, we classify it as red. It's a way of drawing a line in space in a way that you can translate to multiple dimensions. And essentially what you're doing is above the plane of your feature, so this plane is our feature space, you are extending another dimension above that plane. So you're drawing a linear function with our feature space as input and a single value as output. And you're taking the line where this surface, where this hyperplane intersects your feature space, that's what you're taking as your decision path. So where this function is zero, that's where it intersects the feature space, that's where it intersects the plane of x1 and x2, and that's our decision path. And if it's bigger than zero, here we call it one, we give one class. If it's smaller than zero here, we give the other class. So if we take our parameter vector w, and we look at what direction it is in our feature space, it's basically perpendicular to our classification boundary, because this is pointing in the direction, remember, of steepest descent. So for this, for this plane, this is the direction of steepest descent. The w is pointing in this direction, perpendicular to this line. So that's how you can imagine how you can think of w for the classification case. So what should the loss function for classification? We know the loss function for regression. Any ideas? In general, when you're trying to do classification, what are you trying to achieve? Yeah, I heard you. Don't be shy.
Classify.
You're trying to classify. Okay, fair enough. So you're trying to classify as many points correctly as you want. You're halfway there. So if you look at all these points, most of them are right, some of them are wrong. So one. Basically, what you're trying to achieve on your training data is the smallest number of misclassified points. So you take the number, the one thing you can do is take the number of blue points in the red area and red points in the blue area, sum them up, and that number you're trying to get as small as possible. Space classification, right? So one way to go is to take the number of misclassified examples, the error, and compute that for every model. So we go back to our model space.
Alright, first we draw another little toy example dataset. So we have this classification dataset here, with just a couple of two features, a couple of input points, and a couple of classes. So these points are blue, I think, and these three points are red. And as you can see, there are a couple of lines that properly classify this.
This data set?
That linearly separate this data set. So what we can do now, we can draw another line through this space with two parameters, W and V.
And we can have a look at what the what this loss function,
this error loss, this loss function,
what that looks like.
Looks like this. I've cheated a little bit, I should mention that. So we have two features now, so actually a classification surface like I described earlier would have three parameters.
So I wouldn't be able to plot it in two dimensions.
So actually I didn't use this approach for this plot, I used a regular raw line, so I fitted a line of two parameters to this space. Which doesn't quite work, but it's good enough to help me with this plot. Because the only thing I really want to illustrate here is that if you define your loss function like this, what you get is flat surfaces and cliffs. So in this whole region here, the loss doesn't change. The loss is exactly the same. So if you do random search in this space, all of your
neighbors will have exactly the all of your samples will have exactly the same loss as your current point.
So you won't know where to go. You won't know where to go until maybe by random chance you hit one of these points and then you sample and then you're allowed to send this steep cliff, send this steep cliff. Then you move into another region. But that's completely random. You have to do a completely random walk until you hit this point. You have to do a completely random walk in this region and so on and so on.
And for gradient descent, you're even more screwed.
Because the gradient here is zero. So gradient descent is telling you, great, you're an optimum. If you put it here, you're an optimum. You put it here, you're an optimum. Here, you're an optimum. Because it's always flat. And this is because if we imagine drawing a line here, and wiggling it a little bit, changing a little bit, changing the parameters around a little bit, the number of misclassified errors is either not going to change,
or it's going to change by one.
So we move from this line to this line, then it's going to change to no error, to error one, suddenly. Or if you move from this line, that's not going to change at all.
But you don't get this nice smooth rolling hills that you want that will tell you where to go and that you won't get them all space.
So the moral of the story is this is not a good loss function. Even though it's exactly what we're trying to optimize,
it's not what we should take out of.
Like expressing properly, it's exactly what we want to optimize, the thing that we want to improve as much as possible, but it's still not a good loss function. It's still not going to help us search. So sometimes your evaluation function, the thing that you're looking to optimize, should not be your loss function.
What can we use instead as a loss function for classification? There are a lot of ways to do this, and we're going to come back to this a couple of times. But just to round off the lecture in a nice way,
let's briefly show you a least squares classifier.
So what we've done here
is basically we turn classification into a regression problem to get a nice smooth loss function. And so it's like taking all the positive examples, let's say these are blue ones, these are the red ones. This is our plane, our feature plane. We turn it into a regression problem where we give all the positive examples the label 1. So the loss is, there should be an x here, sorry. So the label here is one for these guys and minus one for these guys. So the residuals is what the model predicts minus the label and what the model predicts minus the label. So that's why there's a plus one. So the red ones get minus one and the blue ones get plus one. And then we fit the line to that. And we look at where the line intersects our decision plane, and that's our feature plane, and that's our decision value. And this is just for a particular model. This is a way to tell us whether or not we've classified correctly. And the advantage here is that as you move your line a little bit back and forth, this function always changes. You don't have these sudden jumps. This function just is smooth and always changes. When you plot it, it looks like this. The eagle-eyed viewers may notice that the parameters have changed because this trick I used earlier to turn it into a two-parameter model space doesn't work. So here I've just fixed the bias, the third parameter, I fixed the one, and I'm plotting it for two different parameters. That's why it looks different from this one, different from this surface. But this is just to show that if you do this, your loss function becomes smooth. And you can do gradient descent and find the middle. So last slide, I guess we stop a little early today. Just a summary. So we started with black box optimization, random search and simulated annealing, and the benefits of these methods are that they're simple, that you only need to evaluate your loss function, you don't need to compute your gradient or understand your model in any way. You just need to define what it is going to optimize and your way. And it works on discrete model spaces. So you can do this on trees, on any kind of model space, any kind of optimization problem you have. But it can be a bit messy and it can be a bit noisy. And it can take a long time to converge. Gradient descent is a lot less messy and a lot less noisy. So so much less noisy that it gets stuck in local minimum. It's very powerful. It only works on continuous model spaces. So if you have trees, if you have this discrete model space like trees, then it doesn't work because you need to compute the gradient, and the gradient you can only compute on a continuous function. And this is very important. Basically, this whole lecture was to introduce you to the idea of gradient descent. And random search and simulated annealing are good to know, but they're just sort of stepping stones to that point. And we're going to come back to this again and again. So if you didn't get it, please have a look at the video, please have a look at the slides, make sure you understand this before we move on. And for classification, what we saw there is that our most natural loss function, the thing that we're actually trying to optimize for, the thing that we actually want to improve, doesn't make for a very good loss function, because the loss function should do two things. It should tell you where to go, and it should be smooth. So it should give you a smooth decision surface. It should give you a smooth loss surface. And one way we can make it smooth is by using what's called a least squares regression. It's not the best way to do it at all, but the other ways to do it require a little bit more probability, a little bit more background, so we'll come back to this problem later and we will show you how to properly set up a loss function for classification. So that's all I had for today. Thank you for your attention, and I will see you Monday.